Jonah Jameson here.
Welcome back to the Daily Bugle. It's been 1 year since the unmasking of Spider-Man by the valiant hero Mysterio, also known as Quentin Beck. Beck bravely died, sacrificing his life to expose the crimes of Peter Parker. But later, files were leaked that seemed to suggest Beck was a con man, using special effects and projections to create the illusion that he was a superhero. Of course, this is a ridiculous claim. I mean, can you imagine the resources required to pull off such a feat? I mean, why wouldn't any of the Avengers know about this? Clearly, this is all an attempt to smear the legacy of one of the greatest superheroes of our time, just so that his memory doesn't eclipse that of their precious Tony Stark. Mayor of New York, Norman Osborn, took on the task of capturing Parker to answer for his crimes. But that same night, he disappeared, and the search has so far been unsuccessful. It seems to me that someone, possibly Parker himself, decided to take Norman out, but he was the only one in this town brave enough to take him on. For the past year, the conversation surrounding this incident is primarily centered around the debate of the identity of Spider-Man. People now believe that Beck was nothing but an illusionist, but that doesn't explain why Beck would claim this random teenager from Queens was the wall crawler. Parker, along with his close friends and family, have denied that he's the one under the mask. Without evidence to the contrary, rumors have continued to spread. We interviewed a student at Parker's High School to get his take. Hello, could you state your name?
The name is Flash. Flash Thompson.
And what was your relation to Parker?
You know, Peter and I, we go way back. I mean, we've been friends since the first grade, and, you know, we're very close. And I'm just saying, you know, Spider-Man is the greatest superhero of all time.
So, in that case, can you tell us if the rumors are true?
The rumors?
That Peter Parker is Spider-Man?
Well, I can neither confirm or deny. All I'll say is I've never seen the two of them next to each other before, so...
We have in the studio today another longtime friend of Peter Parker, Ned Leeds. Good morning, Ned.
Good morning.
You're on the side of people that believe that Parker isn't Spider-Man, is that right?
Yeah, that's right. And I don't believe he isn't Spider-Man, I know he isn't.
But how do you explain Mysterio picking him out of all people?
Well, it really all comes down to Stark. Of course, it always comes down to Stark.
You see, Beck had a grudge against Stark because Stark stole the credit for his illusion tech. The leaks showed this. So he wanted to find a way to get back at him after his death. And a few years ago, well, you know, this was before the blip, Peter was given an internship at Stark Industries. He was the only person who was ever afforded this opportunity. Ned hands over the picture that Peter took with Tony at the Avengers compound with the certificate for the internship. It seems obvious, to me at least, that Beck was angry at Peter because Peter was just some kid from Queens, and he who had worked at Stark Industries for so long was given nothing and his invention was stolen. Beck wanted to attack everything and anything that related to Stark in some way, and Peter happened to have that kind of connection to Stark, so Beck picked him to take the fall.
With all the shady things that Stark has done before and even during his tenure as Iron Man, which you admit to being aware of, do you really think he's worth defending?
Neither I or Peter defend Tony's failings, but I don't think we can judge people by their worst mistakes. I think with all the good Tony has done, I would like to think that outweighs the bad, don't you?
I do not. Anyway, that's all the time we have. Thanks for joining us.
My pleasure.
So, what do you think at home? Is Peter Parker Spider-Man? And more importantly, is Spider-Man a threat or a menace? What? Ned walks through the streets of New York.
He stops when he sees an ad for a New York bulletin paper entitled Spider-Man No More. 1 year later, Ned walks towards an apartment building. A security guard in a car on the other side of the street watches Ned and calls in to inform of his arrival. Ned walks up the stairs and walks up to a door. As he walks down the hallway, a half dozen security guards watch him. He goes up to the door and knocks on it. After a few seconds, the door opens. I saw what you said in the bugle. Jameson's mind is not easily changed. You really didn't have to do that for me. That's what friends do, Peter. They stand by each other. Peter and Ned do their signature handshake and hug. Hey, Ned. You're right on time. We cut to after the lunch. Peter, Ned, Aunt May, and Happy all gather around the table and talk about old memories and all the things that led them to this point. In the conversation, we understand how Peter has been dealing with all the suspicion put on him. He still attends Midtown High, but at a distance. He submits his homework and exams from home, something the school agreed to for the sake of his security and the security of the school, as neither party wants Midtown High to be targeted in any way. Peter also won't let May leave the apartment, or rarely anyway, too afraid that someone will go after her. Happy wasn't fired. In fact, he got a promotion. The relationship with Pepper and Stark Industries is repaired. Stark Industries, in fact, hired all the security guards who watch the apartment building and accompany May and Peter on the occasions where they leave the apartment. The conversation turns to the prom, which happens to be tonight. Ned announces that he's going with Betty. May is obviously very happy for him, but Peter asks, "Wait, you guys are back together?" "It's complicated." "It's always complicated." Happy looks at May, a little slightly offended. "I mean teenage love. Everything is complicated at that age." They ask Peter if he's going to the prom, and Peter repeats what he's told them several times in the past over the last few weeks. The answer is no. May says she talked to the school and they said they'd be willing to make an exception for Peter to come for this one event. Peter emphasizes that it's too dangerous and besides he doesn't have anyone to go with. We then cut to a few hours later. Peter and Ned are playing video games. Peter only owns a PlayStation 2, so that's what they're playing on. Ned checks the time and realizes that it's time for him to go and get ready for the prom. Peter accompanies him to the door and sees him out. Peter sees May alone in the kitchen, and he walks over to her. Happy's taking a nap, isn't he? Yeah. Guess that stuffed turkey really did him in, huh? The two laugh. May eventually changes the subject. You know, Peter, I've been thinking, maybe it's just time that we told the world the truth. You serious? I know how you feel. I get it. I honestly never thought in a million years that one day I'd have this position. But I can see it. It's killing you. I have to keep you all safe. Peter, your friends are becoming adults now. They're probably going to move away to somewhere where you can't protect them. And Happy is here for me now. I have all the protection I need. If all of Tony Stark's resources and the dozen security guards out there wasn't enough. I know you want to protect us, but I'm telling you that you don't have to anymore. Peter stays silent. Do the prom, Peter. You deserve a bit of fun after everything you've gone through. You deserve a moment to live. If you're not going to do it for yourself, then do it for me. Alright. Fine. I'll do it. Thank you. Aunt May helps Peter get ready. If only Ben were here to see this. An unexpected ring at the door alerts them. Who's that? Are we expecting anyone? May doesn't answer. Peter heads for the door. You know what? It's probably probably just Ned. He might have forgotten something. Face it, Tiger. You just hit the jackpot. What are you doing here? What does it look like I'm doing? I'm taking you to the prom. She didn't put you up to this, did she? No, she didn't. In fact, I'm the one who called her to ask her permission. I know how you feel about us being together. And I completely understand. I really do. But at least for one night, let us be happy. Happy walks in. Are we all ready to go? Really? You knew about this too? Everyone laughs. Peter and Michelle are in the back of Happy's car. Neither one really knows what to say. Peter awkwardly turns to her. I like the hair. Thanks. Peter looks out ahead of him, through the windshield, and just smiles to himself. This emotion almost confuses him. What are you thinking about? Well, you know, it's weird. I just realized I'm actually kind of nervous. There's nothing weird about that. It's prom, everyone's shit nervous. Yeah, but I mean, that's my point. For the first time in so long, I'm actually nervous about something a random teenager from Queens should have any right to be nervous about. No world-ending threats or armed supervillains. Just high school celebration. Happy rolls down the window, separating him and the passenger seats. All right, we're here. Are you ready? Not at all. Great, me neither. Let's do this. As they walk to the entrance, heads begin turning. Peter notices but brushes it off. Michelle drags Peter through the sea of students. They find a comfortable position in the middle of the crowd to dance, but Peter can't help but notice that all eyes are on him. His nervousness and unease is felt by Michelle. Hey, don't worry about them. Just focus on me, alright? Can you do that? Yeah, I think I can. The two dance. Parker! Flash walks up to Peter and stares him in the eyes. Both of the respective dates and a large part of the crowd around them anticipate a fight is about to break out. But to everyone's surprise, mad respect. Flash bro hugs Peter. Respect for what? You know. But I'm not. Oh, yeah, sure, yeah. Just between us, yeah? Flash winks at Peter before he walks off with his date. Peter turns to Michelle. Whatever happened to Penis Parker? They laugh. Peter spots Ned and Betty walking in. Ned sees Peter, and the two nod at each other. Peter and Michelle join the other students in enjoying their evening as the screen fades to black. We then have a montage of Peter completing his final exams. We cut back to the apartment. Home. Yes, I am home. Peter picks up a letter and opens it. He looks confused and surprised. What is it? It's from Midtown. They made me valedictorian. May is overcome with joy. Oh God, that means I'm gonna have to write a speech, won't I? It's probably the most important speech of your life. You're not helping. We then cut to the graduation ceremony. The students gather. They all walk along and accept their diplomas one by one. Once everyone has received their diplomas, the speaker introduces Peter to make his speech. Hey everyone. If you told me 4 years ago, or 9 years depending, back when this all started, this high school odyssey, that I'd end up being chosen to do a speech, a valedictorian one at that, not only would I have had a lot of questions about who you are and why you're telling me this, but I probably wouldn't have believed you. The audience chuckles. Now, look, it's probably cliche to say we've been through a lot, but it's perhaps never been as true as it has been for our generation. A generation that grew up with a new age of superheroes, and a world that has evolved at an exponential rate. And also half the planet vanished into dust. So, yeah, I think we've earned the right to say that we've been through a lot. But we did it together. At least most of us. Now look, you could say that I wasn't exactly the popular kid, and that would be an understatement. But things change. And now I'm probably the most talked about student Midtown High will ever have. And I do want to address those rumors. I know it's all you guys can think about anyway. This time last year, my world got turned upside down in more ways than one. And I thought dying was as bad as it got. I know why Beck chose my name. I think you all do too. It wasn't random. It was deliberate. You didn't just flip through the yellow pages and they just happened to be extremely unlucky. So I don't blame you. Nor do I blame literally every other person on the planet for falling for it. But I'm here to settle this. Once and for all. Peter looks down at his speech notes. Because the truth is, I am. The sound of a web stops Peter, along with the crowd. And Spider-Man lands right next to Peter. The crowd goes wild. Gasps, shock. Cell phones get pulled out and plenty of pictures taken. I think I can finish that sentence for you. Peter Parker is not Spider-Man. Spider-Man leaps off the stage and swings away. Cut to a little bit later. The students are gathering with their friends and families. Peter walks from the back of the stand, still trying to understand what just happened, when he sees Ned. Hey Peter, what just happened? Well, you know how he kept that projector? No. No, Ned, you did that? It's the least I could do. Flash, in the distance, sees Peter. Way to go, Penis Parker. Peter smiles. There it is. Oh, hey, my mom's here. She's most definitely going to want a picture, so I'll be right back. Peter looks off at the Hudson River. Happy walks up to him. What a show, huh? Hey, Happy. It was a good speech you gave there. Well, I didn't predict I'd be upstaged by myself. Happy chuckles. Hey, look, I kind of wanted to ask you something. Yeah, sure, anything. Normally this isn't the kind of thing that I'd have to ask you, but without any senior members of the family around, I figured you'd be the best person to ask. Ask what? Your blessing. Blessing? For what? I want to ask May to marry me. Peter is stunned. Oh, wow. Look, I understand that Ben was, you know, like a father to you, and I don't want you to think that I'm coming in here to fill his shoes, and because that's not my intention at all. Happy. It's okay. You just caught me by surprise, that's all. The answer's yes. And don't worry, it'll be hers too. Happy smiles and walks away. Thank you. Peter turns around and sees Michelle, standing only a few feet away. The two don't even know what to say anymore. The whole situation has robbed them of all words that could be spoken. They just walk up to each other and hug. And in this moment, all of the stress, anxiety, and pressure is released, and tears start filling their eyes. Hey, am I interrupting? The two see Ned has come back. They smile and bring him into the group hug. The shot lingers on this group, a party of three, they who've endured so much, but done it together, every step of the way. And now, it's finished. Much more awaits them. Their lives have only just begun. But for the time being, in each other's arms, they are home. And that's Spider-Man Homeless, or my pitch for a third MCU Spider-Man film. I honestly never thought it would end up being or taking this long to make, but, well, here we are. Yes, don't worry, there will be a post-credit scene, but before that, let's recap. This epilogue to the film, and in a way to the trilogy as a whole, had to do two things. Firstly, satisfyingly wrap up a story told over three movies, or six if you include the other Avengers movies appearances, and leave the story in a way that should this be the end, as Sony's contract with Marvel might given the current circumstances, the story ends on a satisfying note, or should they extend the contract, that the ending is open-ended enough that there's room for the story to grow. So naturally, the main thing that had to be addressed was the question of Peter's identity. There was honestly two different ways I could have gone with this. Either Peter confirms the identity, or he is proved innocent and not the one under the mask. The former was addressed last time, but the latter is what this epilogue had to cover. I ultimately sided with Peter being shown to not be Spider-Man. The reason being that I think future stories, should they happen in this universe, would be more interesting with this element in place. Peter is practically the only hero in the MCU to have a secret identity, so it would be a shame in my eyes to take away permanently one of the things that sets him apart. That being said, I did want to continue the Tony Stark parallel to some extent, as that is what both of the previous films did, but here with a twist. Peter is about to reveal his identity in the same way that Tony did in the first Iron Man by saying, "I am Iron Man," or in this case, Spider-Man. But here, Ned steps in and utilizes the projector they retrieved from Mysterio to create an illusion, putting Spider-Man next to Peter and proving, at least as far as the audience is concerned, that they are not the same person. As for the relationship between the trio, I purposefully left their relationship at the end rather ambiguous. Obviously, they're still all friends, but I left Peter and Michelle's relationship up in the air. They could get back together, they could not. I felt leaving it on that note of uncertainty at a moment in these characters' lives where everything is about to change as they graduate and head off to college was most appropriate. As for the fate of the villains, I wanted to leave it mostly open-ended as well, to leave room in case of sequels, while still giving a satisfying end to their respective journeys. Scorpion finally gets his chance at revenge, which was teased at the end of Homecoming. Obviously, he doesn't succeed, but, you know, he at least gets a chance. And Vulture gets to go free. And I thought that this would be better than a full redemption or a full turn all the way back to evil, leaving things a bit more bittersweet between, you know, Peter and his first real nemesis in this franchise. There are a whole bucket load of callbacks to earlier MCU Spider-Man films and appearances. I'm not going to list them all and I'll let you find them on your own. But small things like Peter starting the speech with the two words that were the first two words we ever heard this character speak in the trailer to Civil War, or bigger things such as various elements that come full circle, like how Far From Home ended with Mysterio using his tech to trick the world and reveal Peter's identity, and this film ending with his tech being used to prove Peter not to be Spider-Man, at least in the eyes of the public. And of course, many more elements. I've gone on about it time and time again throughout this pitch, if it wasn't obvious enough. I just really like the idea of things neatly coming full circle, so there's a lot of callbacks to Homecoming, and obviously many to Far From Home, as this is a direct sequel. Thematically, this film continues on the theme of identity from the last film, which, given the ending of that film, it couldn't really be avoided. But whereas that film centers around Peter having to move out of Tony's shadow, this film is about Peter learning that succeeding on your own means knowing to accept the help of others. In Homecoming, Peter was hell-bent on proving to Tony that he was responsible enough to take on things by himself. In Far From Home, having proven that, he has to learn to stop relying on Tony and letting his memory affect him. And finally, in Homeless, Peter is forcibly stripped of Stark and has to make it on his own, but comes to learn to accept the help of the people that love him. This, of course, is very much a metaphor for becoming an adult. You are stripped of the benefits that being a child offers, and you're forced to make it on your own, but without accepting the help of people that love you, you will drown, and accepting the help doesn't make you any less independent, nor does it take away from your accomplishments. Spider-Man has always been the story of a boy becoming a man, and this, in my eyes, is the best way of incorporating that into this version of Peter's journey. Also, before I go, a small note about the end credits. I didn't really have time to detail the whole thing, but I just thought it'd be neat if the end credits were presented like a graduation yearbook with scribbles and doodles and what have you. Anyway, thank you so much for watching this series. The response has been truly incredible and I cannot thank you enough. I hope this ending satisfied you, because endings are very hard to write. I mean, any writer will tell you that. And I hope that it worked for you. I really do. And I hope that you enjoyed the ride. As I said, I didn't expect it to take
this long, but nevertheless, it has, and, you know, it's been kind of an adventure, and I'm almost all emotional myself, putting this whole thing to bed. So, I really hope that you did enjoy this while it lasted. Very soon, I will be uploading a full version of this with all of the parts combined into what's going to be a feature-length pitch. And I've got a ton of ideas for future pitches, so stay tuned for that. If you want to let me know what you thought of this pitch, I'd love to hear your thoughts in the comments below. I really love reading them. And if you want to share your own pitch for a third MCU Spider-Man film, or give me recommendations for pitches you'd like to see, put those in the comments. I would love to see your suggestions. Thank you again so much for watching, and if you want to see more of this, then be sure to like the video and subscribe so you're sure you won't miss future videos. Enjoy this post-credit scene, and goodbye. We cut back to the apartment as Peter returns home by himself. Suddenly, a portal opens and Doctor Strange emerges. Peter Parker. Oh, hey Doc, and long time no see. I need your help. Oh, sure, you need help with the mystic eggs? This is no laughing matter. The fate of the multiverse is at stake. Okay, no. At last time, some guy with a cape showed up. This is a cloak. Talking about the multiverse and all that. I mean, he tried to kill me and all of my friends. So, no, I'm not interested. Well, if to you, seeing is believing, I suggest you look behind you. Peter turns around and a new portal opens, and from it emerges.
What the fuck?